Thanks, Mark. Thanks, Mark. It's great to be here today. This is the 9th OCP Summit, and I was discussing this with Rocky and Mark, and you know, OCP has come such a long way since its founding back in 2011. Now it's the 9th OCP Summit, and over these years, we have seen so many contributions, so many areas of open source hardware being contributed by an increasing amount of the community. But you know, the key thing about OCP is really about innovation. And today, in my talk, we'll cover two key areas of innovation, one in security and the other in storage, that we will help to move the industry along with the, you know, with the OCP community. To get started, first, let's take a look at Microsoft and OCP. Microsoft joined OCP in 2014, and since that time, there's been several contributions made for open source hardware. The most recent one back in late 2016 was what we called Project Olympus, which was Microsoft's latest cutting-edge server hardware that we are deploying in our data centers. The interesting thing at that time was that we said, let's try something new where we would want to develop open hardware in the same manner as open source software. Why can't we do that, right? Why can't we release specifications early when they are sort of half-baked, 50% complete or so, and then work with everybody in the community to build them to its final stage? It was an experiment, but it worked really well. So we announced last year, when we were here on stage, that Project Olympus was a success, and it's been deployed in Azure. And in fact, there was expansion around the ecosystem with JBots and GPU boxes and flash storage and so on. So it's become sort of a de facto standard in a way. So then we started thinking, okay, so now that we have made great progress in OCP for server and storage, of course, along with other companies that are contributing, what are the next big challenges we need to tackle? And the top two that came to mind were security and storage. For security, we contributed Project Cerberus, and I'll talk a little more about that in a couple of slides. And that was to address a critical part of security in the hardware stack, which was not being addressed in a standardized way. So let's go to security. So this is a very interesting quote from our CEO. And you know, there is a deep, profound truth in this. Essentially, you know, we all aspire to have a secure infrastructure, to have security so that you know, we don't have attacks happen, and so on. But you can't just do that by watching others do it. You have to be involved in it every single day. Right? Threats keep changing, the attacks models keep changing, and what every company has to do is to keep up with them. Right? You have to invent new techniques to prevent those attacks. You have to make sure that infrastructure is patched and up to date. It's a constant evolution as the threat models change. Microsoft is currently investing about $1 billion in security R&D, and that goes a long way to ensuring that there are new standards and the cloud is secure and the industry benefits as a whole and adoption grows, which is the key metric at the end of the day. And that's where hardware security comes in. If you look at the security landscape of all the areas that need to be addressed for security, one key aspect in the context of OCP is hardware security. You know, there are certain attack vectors that are sort of concerning that weren't being addressed. Supply chain attacks, at time of manufacturing, during assembly of hardware, during shipping and supply chain of the hardware. How do we protect against attacks that happen there? How do we protect against attacks by malicious operators who are in the data center with administrative privileges? It's a very rare instance, but you want to make sure that it can't happen. How do you protect against attacks where you have compromised firmware that can be updated on the server and you have no idea that a rootkit got installed? How do you protect against that? So to protect against these different types of new attack vectors, we announced what we call Project Cerberus, which is a new industry standard to provide a hardware root of trust, which goes beyond other roots of trust that exist in today's server platforms. Essentially, what Cerberus is, it's a tamper-proof cryptographic microcontroller that gives you the assurance that the firmware that is loaded on the server is signed and attested, right? So with that confidence, you know that whether you're during boot, whether you're at runtime, the firmware that's on the server has not been compromised. It does protect against attacks I mentioned earlier. And I think the cool thing about this is that it is agnostic to the CPU or I/O providers. It can scale from IoT devices through data center devices. So it's a specification that we think can be applicable to NICs, SSDs, hard drives, GPUs, CPUs, the whole spectrum. And there's been a lot of progress in the ecosystem since we announced this. Now, this is the best part I like about OCP. The best talent of the industry comes together, and we kind of put our heads together to solve a common problem. And you see for servers, you know, there are companies that are building microcontrollers, there are cloud providers, there are system companies, there are CPU companies, and all of these are coming together to create this specification that will be the foundation for hardware security. This is what OCP is really about, the collaboration that happens in an open environment. So it's exciting to see this progress on Cerberus, and you know, if you haven't seen it yet, I will highly encourage you to go read the specification and be part of the effort. So let's move on to the second area of innovation, and this is a new announcement that we're making today, and I'm very excited to bring this forth for OCP. It's a new project we are announcing, which we are calling Project Denali. That, of course, is a picture of Denali up in Alaska, after which we named the project. We tend to name our projects after mountains for the most part. But before we go into the details, let us take a view of why do we need to do innovation in this area. And this is for flash storage. So just a little bit of context here. About 30% of global flash output is consumed by the enterprise and the cloud, that combination. Of that 30%, roughly about 50 to 60% of that flash output is consumed by the big cloud companies. You know, most of them are part of OCP. And then of that amount, Microsoft itself consumes multi-exabytes of flash storage. Now, if you think about that for a second, an exabyte is a billion gigabytes, right? And Microsoft is just one of the cloud providers, and we consume that amount of flash storage, and it amounts to billions of dollars in annual spend. So when you're operating a cloud at that scale, you want to drive every bit of efficiency out of the designs. You want to make sure that you can operate the infrastructure for a 24/7 environment. You want to make sure that you have the agility to roll new technologies. These are the kind of problems that we are facing in our infrastructure. And to be specific, the challenges we have with today's SSDs are manifold. You know, the first problem is that SSDs started on the wrong foot, in a way. They were sort of an emulation of the hard drive. They presented a sort of a block interface, and they were pretending to be a hard drive. And this helped with backward compatibility and helped SSDs gain adoption. But you know, even today, we haven't gone past that limitation, right? So we are not exposing the performance that is available in the flash devices. Another big problem we face is the SSD device is completely monolithic. And what that means is that when there is innovation in new NAND media, when there is innovation in some algorithms, you can't take advantage of that by itself. It all has to come together into a brand new device, new media, new controllers, new firmware. And that whole device has to be tested, verified, and then deployed. And even then, what you find is that between different suppliers, the performance is different. The latency parameters are different. The way the updates are done is different. The failure characteristics are different. So it creates a lot of problem when you're operating at scale with millions of SSDs deployed. So beyond this, I think one more big challenge we have is that these SSDs are not designed to be cloud-friendly. And what I mean by that is, at cloud scale, you know, there are several workloads that are running in the cloud. You can imagine in a public cloud, there are workloads, high-performance computing workloads, you know, email, virtual machines running in-memory databases. There are so many different workloads. How do you adapt to these different workload parameters but use only the same SSD? It doesn't work today, right? It's a black box. How do we get past this limitation? Now, what we did to address some of these challenges a couple years ago was we released a specification called the Cloud SSD specification to OCP, and that helped a bit to bring sort of this standardization to the industry. And that is part of the OCP specification today. But that helped a little bit in getting all the parameters together. But then what happened was, you know, we started seeing, you know, sort of fragmentation in the industry because new functionality was starting to get built into the SSD. KV accelerators, search engines, you know, accelerators for erasure coding and DDO, they were all getting put into the SSD, but not in a consistent manner, which was the big issue. Every supplier had a different way of doing it. So then the thing is, you see innovation, which is great, but you can't drive adoption. And that's a limiter to getting the industry to adopt a new technology. So we started thinking about 2 years ago, how do we get past this? How do we start to drive a new standard, a new way to sort of revolutionize how SSDs are done? It can't be too complicated, because complications mean slower adoption and more design complexity. So what we did was we followed one of the key principles that we're seeing in the industry. If all of you have noticed the trends in the industry for disaggregation, you know, the networking stack is a great example. A couple years ago, you know, Microsoft, Facebook, and several other companies were up here, and they talked about how the networking stack was disaggregated. The hardware was one, the OS was another piece, and the application stack was another. And that led to so much innovation in the networking space. Why can't we do the same thing for SSDs? Why can't we start to separate the stacks and create interfaces between those? That was one of the things. How do you make the SSD to be cloud first? It should be designed to operate at scale. And if you do that, of course, it will operate in an enterprise environment anyway. How do you make sure that you have agility to incorporate new technologies for NAND? You know, there are so many new NAND technologies that are coming out. There's low latency NAND. There is QLC NAND. There is storage class memory. With all this innovation happening at the media layer, how do you make sure you can have the agility to bring those on board when these new NAND types come out? And the last one, of course, is about the application itself. How do you get software-defined data placement, software-defined algorithms that can work in tight coordination with the SSD? That's what Project Denali is about. How do we solve those problems? So let's take a look at what exactly it does. So here you have today's monolithic model. You have a sort of a black box device which has all the functionality in it combined, and it is presented to the host, and the applications on the host, they will interact with the device. So what Denali does is essentially disaggregate two key pieces of this architecture. The lower layer is what we are calling the media management layer, and that is what the SSD should be. You know, that is the concept of what is known in the industry as perfect NAND. You know, the media controller or the media layer, its job should be to make sure that it can take care of things like ECC and bad blocks and manage the media and present to the layers above perfect NAND, where you always have an array of NAND that is available for at a certain latency and so on, right? And then once you have that figured out, then you start to bring apart these two layers where the media guys can innovate on the NAND and how you manage that, and they can move at their own pace. And the layer above, which is the software-defined layer, or the software placement layer, that can operate by itself. And this is where the cloud comes in. So the intelligence of how you manage the NAND itself can then move up into the stack. And when we talk about all these different workloads in the cloud, they can optimize for their own patterns. If you have a random read-only pattern versus a random write pattern versus a mixed workload, the application knows the pattern of the workload the best. It can optimize for that, and then it can figure out what is the best way to lay the data out on the device. And what that will lead to eventually is a better write amplification, which is known in the industry as WAF, a lower WAF number. It will lead to lower cost, because now you can take a lower cost media, you can take probably consumer NAND, and still be able to get the performance and efficiency as if it was enterprise NAND. You can get better performance just by getting the right data layouts in and exposing the parallelism of flash. Now, so there's a lot of benefits from doing this disaggregation. The P block interface that's shown on the slide, that is what the Denali specification is about. Now, there is one more model here. So you see that in this model, the host, which is the CPU complex, is where the intelligence logic is running. But that's not the only way to do it. And the point of creating a standard is so that we give choices and we give flexibility so that different companies can innovate on top of that. So one other model that's also possible with Denali is to have the intelligence layer move into an offload accelerator. Right? So you see that the address mapping, garbage collection, those functionalities now move into a system on chip or an FPGA, depending on how the implementation is done. And now this, and you can put a bunch of accelerators in there, accelerators for compression, for encryption, for dedupe, for erasure coding. And the cool thing about having this separation between the media layer and the data management layer is that now you can think at a bigger scale. Well, you can think about, how do I do these accelerator functions across a cluster of computers? How do I do this across a whole data center? Right, you can do these policy management. How do I do security? How do I do key management? You can start to think at a bigger scale because of this disaggregation that just happened. And that is the kind of innovation we'll want to see in the ecosystem as we start to separate these layers and have each layer focus on what it does best. That is what Project Denali is about. Since we started discussing this with the ecosystem, we have seen a tremendous amount of progress. In addition to Microsoft, we've been working closely with CNX Labs, and there's other companies also that have very excited to join this project, and it ranging from NAND media companies to controller companies to even system companies. So, and we expect that now that this is a contribution to OCP, we'll have even more momentum to drive this specification as the next industry standard for flash storage. So to discuss a little bit more about Project Denali, let me please call on stage Alan Armstrong, CEO of CNX Labs, and Andy Bechtolsheim, who is an OCP board member. Andy and Alan, can you please come up stage? Hey, Alan. Hey, Andy. Thanks for joining us on stage, Alan and Andy. So just I wanted to ask you a couple of questions so the audience can get your perspective on Denali. So Alan, could you give us a little bit of a history of how this project started?
Sure. So CNX was actually founded on an idea of building a solid state controller. Actually, we were founded in 2013 to build a controller for non-volatile memories that we could seamlessly move functions from the host to the controller. And do that in a very easy and seamless fashion. We started actually working with all flash array companies at first, but realized very quickly that it was something that could be applied in the cloud. And then we started working with members of the Linux community and building an ecosystem on an early version of Denali, where we could start sampling systems to universities and companies, many of the companies out here, and really showcase this technology. And then along the way, about 2.5 years ago, we were lucky enough to start working with Kushagra and his team at Microsoft, doing various levels of POC to showcase the technology internally. And now we're here where we are with the announcement of Denali and ready to take this to the next level.
Yeah, it's been a great journey. Andy, from your perspective, what kind of innovation and future technologies do you think this will enable?
Yeah, so from my perspective, the great thing about OCP is that it really accelerates innovation. In this particular case, it allows large cloud companies and vendors to get together to redefine the interface between the server system and the flash, which will, you know, reduce time to market, improve performance, really take advantage of the low latencies coming up next. In a conventional standards body world, this would have probably take years to accomplish. So I hope we will get this done in a couple of months.
Yeah, and that's the part I'm looking forward to, kind of the innovation we can drive by doing the standardization. Alan, could you give us an update on what is the current status of Denali. Is it just a concept or is it real? How do you?
That was a good lead-in. It's going to be earlier than a couple of months. So we actually have a M.2 that we're showcasing actually on the show floor. This is a 1 and 2 terabyte, supports NVMe and the current version of the Denali spec, and it will be deployed in data centers later this year in production. And we're really looking forward to working with the members of the JDF, great list of companies, to really take this spec, make it something that can truly scale into standard hardware that can scale massively and really revolutionize the data center storage.
Right, and that's exactly where the OCP community comes in because of the open source. So Andy, what are your perspective on how can the OCP community help to advance this specification and drive it as a new standard?
Yeah, so in this particular case, obviously the initial standard was in fact written by the companies participating here, but it will benefit the whole community. So once this becomes available as a standard product, hopefully later this year, everybody can take advantage of this.
Great, thank you so much for being on stage and get your perspective. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Andy. So the next steps are basically the specification is being contributed to OCP, and we'll be kicking off the Denali forum. So you'll start to see the specification, and you'll have an opportunity to read it, give feedback, contribute to it, and we solicit participation so that we can drive this next standard. To hear a little bit more about both Project Cerberus and Project Denali, we have a short video that I would like to show you. That shows perspectives of both the Microsoft Azure CTO and also some of our key partners. So I'll be back in a couple minutes.
Security is all about trust. Up to this point, there has been no standard for hardware security. Different devices either don't have security or implement their own custom security. At Microsoft and Azure, we believe in transparency across all aspects of security. Cerberus is a security coprocessor that establishes a root of trust in itself for all of the hardware devices that are on a computing platform, whether that's an IoT device or a server device, so that the device can both launch securely as well as attest to the fact that it's launched securely.
A customer having trust in the infrastructure is really an enabler for them to adopt cloud-based services. Cerberus provides a hardware-based root of trust that ensures all firmware is signed and from a valid source, making sure no malicious firmware can run on the server.
Intel has a shared vision with Microsoft of improving security to provide confidence that the data being processed in the cloud is running on hardware with uncompromised firmware, as well as to protect against potential supply chain attacks. Customers will benefit from OCP standards and innovation in security as it allows customers to focus on their business priorities, knowing their data and platform is secure.
By standardizing on a processor like Cerberus, which can be applied to any of these different devices, whether it's a disk or CPU, we can establish a common trust chain and security posture for the entire hardware platform.
Cerberus would lead to a robust ecosystem of multiple vendors all working together to increase security for the cloud.
The cloud is going through an amazing growth, and we see that in Azure doubling every year. We see no end to that in sight, and a lot of that comes from the hardware innovations.
Intel is excited to see innovative approaches such as Microsoft's Project Denali. The flexibility of Project Denali enables parallel hardware and software innovation to maximize the value for customers while leveraging industry standard baseline of NVMe Express.
Today's SSDs are good at what they do, but they're limited in the trade-offs that the cloud and hyperscalers can make. Project Denali provides a framework for an infrastructure that's truly cloud first.
Up to this point, drive manufacturers have been designing it for a one-size-fits-all strategy. Their firmware is programmed for and tuned for specific workloads. The fact is that the workloads are very diverse in a cloud environment, and so by standardizing at a lower level that gives software more control over the behavior of the device, we can tune dynamically for different workloads and achieve better performance at a lower cost.
Project Denali allows the hardware companies to build simpler, less complicated hardware, which can lower cost by as much as 50%, increase time to market, and allow new NAND and memory technologies to come out faster.
The modular architecture proposed by Project Denali will enable agility for new NAND media adoption, along with improved workload performance by tighter integration between application and the SSD device.
OCP is creating the future of hardware and standardizing that future so that everybody can take advantage of it. The kinds of hardware innovations that we see today will look primitive in a few years. The kinds of efficiency and power savings that we see and cost will be dramatically improved across all those dimensions through the contributions of all of the ecosystem. OCP, really about the future.
Thank you. So it's really exciting to be able to contribute this to OCP. And we have several sessions today and tomorrow where you can learn more about Project Olympus, Denali, and Cerberus. If you have the time, I would highly encourage you to attend some of these sessions. There's also sessions on networking with Sai and Sonic. So with that, thanks for being here. I hope you have a great OCP Summit. Thank you.